Powerlessness begets powerlessness, and that cycle can magnify when machine learning increases the efficiency of activities designed to maximize profit. Improving the micro-targeting of marketing and the predictive pricing of insurance and credit can magnify the cycle of poverty. In this video, I'll explore what's sometimes referred to as predatory micro-targeting. Now, look, this is a broad subjective area and ultimately a question of economics, and it's a topic that potentially puts you on a slippery slope towards questioning capitalism as a whole, which is certainly not my intention for this course. But I do feel strongly that a review of the ethical considerations of machine learning must include the potential adverse effects of micro-targeting. I mean, only to lay out the considerations for you. I can't rigorously define what's okay and what's predatory. Only you can determine where the line's drawn. I only would contend that the question should be widely discussed and considered. So, as with predicting sensitive info about individuals, as I covered in the prior video, we're again discussing the ironic possibility of models predicting too well. If they fulfill their purpose with extreme proficiency, this may disenfranchise individual consumers. After all, companies gain from the power of machine learning. Does this come only from a great loss of power for consumers? Is this a zero-sum game, at least in certain arenas? Highly targeted ads are more adept than ever at aggressively identifying vulnerable consumers and separating them from their money. In her book, Weapons of Math Destruction, Kathy O'Neill expresses her concern that machine learning's power to identify the vulnerable lends to corporate leaching. She says mathematical models can sift through data to locate people who are likely to face great challenges, whether from crime, poverty, or education. It's up to society whether to use that intelligence to reject and punish them or to reach out to them with the resources they need. Take consumer debt, for example. Predicting a poor credit risk is, to some degree, a self-fulfilling prophecy that can hurl those less financially secure into a vicious cycle. Improving financial risk models magnifies that cycle. Fewer false negatives means more impoverished individuals are denied credit or are given loans with higher interest rates. Now, for certain kinds of exploitative, predatory loans, the ethics are clearly substandard. There are stories of mobile apps in developing countries that use bait-and-switch marketing to lure into short-term loans with interest rates of 300% and up. Certainly, in that case, the power of micro-targeting to improve their ability to sell these loans would only make matters worse. So it's a matter of extremes, and there's like a continuum. As for like above-board lenders that aren't so clearly predatory, it's a judgment call. Your role is to explore where to draw the line and to contribute to the discussion. And consider insurance pricing. The name of the game is to charge more for those at higher risk. Left unchecked, this process can quickly slip into predatory pricing. For example, a churn model might find that elderly policyholders don't tend to shop around and defect to better offers, so there's less of an incentive to keep their policy premiums in check. And pricing premiums based on other life factors also contribute to a cycle of poverty. For example, individuals with poor credit ratings are charged more for car insurance. In fact, a low credit score can increase your premium more than an at-fault car accident. This is a result of the predictive discovery found by risk modelers that I mentioned in the prior course. Car accidents are more likely among those with lower credit ratings. This means that someone lacking in financial power in general must now also pay more for car insurance in particular. To what degree does micro-targeting further divide an already stratified society? That's an open question, but must remain an ongoing discussion. Alexander Furness wrote in The Atlantic, "When we think in terms of power, it's clear we're getting a raw deal. We grant private entities with no interest in the public good and no public accountability greater powers of persuasion than anyone's ever had before, And in exchange, we get free email. On the other hand, protecting groups with less power by limiting data collection could backfire. In their book, Prediction Machines, AJ Agrawal and his co-authors said, suppose only rich people from California and New York provide data to the prediction machines. Then the AI will learn to serve those communities. If the purpose of limiting the collection of personal data is to protect the vulnerable, then it opens up a new vulnerability. Users won't benefit from the better products and greater wealth that AI enables. This is sometimes called the coded gaze. Less data about a group can mean that group's not served as well. With the group underrepresented in the training data, predictive models won't work as well for members of the group. This has been shown for both face recognition and for speech recognition. This can result in exclusionary experiences and discriminatory practices. In the next video, I'll cover another area where predictive models can contribute to a cycle of disadvantage: predictive policing.